First part of our intriguing look at the early years of cinema. Each week there's a different theme, and tonight the first looks at how cinematic invention hooked into the late 19th century obsession with machines like trains, planes and automobiles, with a selection of films from the Lumiere brothers and Thomas Edison.
This is a trip back to the beginning of our century, to the moment when history was first caught by the moving pictures. It's the story of early filmmaking and of the first movies and their audiences. But it's also about the figures in the shadows, writers, artists, and visionaries of all kinds who looked forward to the age of cinema and to the modern world that came with it.
It was 100 years ago that pictures began to move, and they were an immediate hit. Audiences found that movies somehow altered everything they showed. Simple things became compelling in a new way, and people were drawn to watch them again and again. Everywhere, people were fascinated by this last and most magical invention of the age of machines. It joined all the other gadgets that allowed Victorians to go faster and further than ever before, on land, at sea, and up in the air. Now you didn't have to risk your neck on the railway or in a horseless carriage, and certainly not in some newfangled flying machine. You could just pay a penny or a nickel at the picture show, and it would take you anywhere. Back on Earth, all the new high-speed travel machines, trains, steamships, balloons, had been brought together by Jules Verne in his novel Around the World in 80 Days, a race against time itself. Amazingly, it was adapted for the Paris Theater in the early 1870s, and people queued round the block to see how on Earth it was going to be staged. They weren't disappointed. It was the most spectacular theater event ever seen, and the birth of a modern popular classic. What Verne had picked up on was that the experience of travel was now more important than the dreary fact of getting from A to B. Travel was no longer about moving, it was about being moved. Mass travel began on the railways. If cinema was the last machine of the Victorian age, the railways were the first. Being a railway passenger was a totally new experience, and often an alarming one. Traveling at unimaginable speeds of anything up to 30 miles an hour, many passengers felt like parcels packed into the train. Worst of all was the horror of being trapped face to face with total strangers. Alice discovered all the new anxieties of railway travel in Looking Glass Land.
Now then, show us your ticket, child.
Don't keep him waiting, child.
His time is worth £1,000 a minute.
I'm afraid I haven't got one. There wasn't a ticket office where I came from.
There wasn't room for one where she came from.
The land there is worth £1,000 an inch.
You're travelling the wrong way.
So young a child ought to know which way she's going, even if she doesn't know her own name.
She ought to know where the ticket office is, even though she doesn't know the alphabet.
She'll have to get back from here as luggage.
Change engines!
Indeed I shan't. I don't belong to this railway journey at all. I was in a wood just now. I wish I could get back there.
Alice's railway journey is probably the weirdest in 19th century literature, but Lewis Carroll was only one of many writers who responded to this new point of view. Victor Hugo and the German poet Heinrich Heine were enthusiasts.
The flowers by the side of the road are no longer flowers. The great streaks of red and white, everything becomes a blur. The fields of grain are like great shocks of yellow hair. Towns and steeples and the trees all mingle and dance on the horizon.
Changes that must now be in our way of looking at things. Space is killed by the railway, so we are simply left with time. I feel as if the mountains and forests of every country are advancing on Paris. I can already smell the linden trees of Germany. The breakers of the North Sea are rolling against my door.
Drivel. I get so bored sitting on a train that after 5 minutes of it, I'm beside myself with the tedium. And people think someone's left a dog in the compartment, but it's me howling. Blur, indeed. What good is a view from the window when you can't see anything properly?
Gustave Flaubert's reaction may have been more typical.
Yes.
Sitting on a train, it felt as if you were still and a panorama was reeling past the window. The way writers describe this effect reminds us how rail travelers had become accidental spectators, forerunners of the first film audiences 50 years later. But there was one passenger who wasn't content to remain a spectator, the French novelist Emile Zola.
My job as a writer isn't to tell pretty stories or to create noble characters. It is to make people feel in every nerve and sinew what I have felt. For my railway story, Le Bête Humaine, I threw myself into the world of railways. I traveled everywhere, came to know railmen, but for the climax of the book, being a passenger wasn't enough. I still had to know, to feel, what happens when a train thunders out of control. There was only one solution. The station was transfixed with horror when this mad train rushed past in a whirlwind of smoke and flame. The engine without driver or fireman, and cattle trucks full of troops yelling patriotic songs. Who cared what victims this machine destroyed on its way? Wasn't it bound for the future? Heedless of spilled blood, with no human hand to guide it through the night, it roared on, a blind and deaf beast let loose amid death and destruction.
Zola's craving for first-hand experience at whatever risk was typical of the age, and in a strange way it also anticipated what would transform simple moving pictures into the new experience of cinema. Zola, with his body lashed to the front of an engine, had done for readers what putting a camera on the front of a locomotive would do for film spectators. Make them feel part of the action. When you look at what writers, artists, and even musicians were doing in the years before cinema arrived, you can find all of the techniques that the movies would soon take over. The close-up, the moving point of view, cross-cutting, the sensation of speed, and the drama of light and dark. They were as much the pioneers of cinema as a new kind of experience, as were the inventors who devised the machinery. Among the barrage of moving pictures available after 1896, it was the Phantom Ride, taken from a moving train, that provided a dynamic new way of seeing. Now, for the price of admission, anyone could be Zola. But the very first moving pictures most audiences saw weren't of a train carving up the countryside, but of a train stopping. Surprisingly to our eyes, the Lumiere's original caused a sensation wherever it was screened and prompted remakes all over the world.
It danced like an arrow straight toward you. It seems it was about to rush into the darkness where you were sitting and then reduce you to a mangled sack of skin and splintered bones and then destroy the whole, whole building. Shh!
The Russian writer Maxim Gorky possibly overdid it. It wasn't long before the first naive response to moving pictures was sent up in the films themselves. Audiences soon got bored with train spotting, and even phantom rides eventually lost their appeal. The question then became how to keep them coming back. The answer was simple. Sex. Train compartments provided the secluded settings for all kinds of goings-on. Film producers started to cash in. They began to offer novelty staged inserts, usually entitled A Kiss in the Tunnel, to spice up the phantom rides. Showmen were encouraged to splice in these inserts wherever they thought best, and so the first edited film stories were created. Continued to fascinate, and sex wasn't the only thing to benefit from train travel. There were new opportunities for crime as well. Producers weren't slow to see the appeal. A daring daylight burglary was the first ever heist movie, and it was set in Sheffield. The audience must have thought, like the burglar, that he'd got away. But the train becomes a trap when, unseen by the audience, the police phone ahead and have him arrested. Here's one of the first lessons of film storytelling, withholding information to make action more dramatic on screen. What you don't see can be just as important to the story as what's shown.
The film did well in Yorkshire, and its maker, Frank Mottershaw, knowing he had a hot property, set out for London to make a killing. He took it to the biggest distributor at the time, an American named Charles Urban. Now, Urban also knew a hot property when he saw it and offered a flat £50 for the world rights. Thinking he had made a good deal, Mottershaw happily took the money and went home. Unluckily for him, the film went on to make a fortune in America, retitled appropriately, Daylight Robbery. Not only was the film a hit, but it proved to be a direct influence on the most famous of all early films, The Great Train Robbery. In filmic terms, the great train robbery also caused a big stir. It was the first time a picture actually threatened you, the audience. Another threat which moving pictures depicted in alarming detail was the arrival of the motor car. The novelty of the automobile inspired another British pioneer, Cecil Hepworth, to produce the first wave of disaster movies. Motoring films are about disaster and mayhem. Despite efforts to curb the anarchy of the automobile, motorists and filmmakers still felt inspired. Motoring films were the training ground for perfecting stunts and special effects, and they did wonders for the crash dummy trade. The public's fascination with motoring was picked up by writers, too. After all, the best loved of all hit-and-run drivers was Mr. Toad.
He increased his pace. And as the car devoured the street and leapt forth on the high road through the open country, he was only conscious that he was Toad once more. Toad at his best and highest. Toad the terror, the traffic queller, the lord of the lone trail, before whom all must give way or be smitten into nothingness and everlasting night.
In the same year as The Wind in the Willows appeared, the Italian poet Marinetti published his futurist manifesto.
We affirm that the world's magnificence has been enriched by a new beauty. The beauty of speed. A racing car whose bonnet is adorned with great pipes like serpents. A roaring car that seems to run on grapeshot is more beautiful than any Greek statue. Faster, you idiot! Faster! Faster!
Whizzing along like Mr. Toad or Marinetti, you could imagine taking off. The motor car had brought the dream of flying closer to reality. At the start of the 20th century, the flying machine was the most eagerly awaited invention of the new age. Cinema gave people a picture of what flying would be like. Its fantasy kept expectations burning until reality could catch up. Before reality did catch up, the only way of getting airborne was by balloon, a perilous form of ascent which had been used since the 18th century by military strategists, town planners, and crackpots. It was Félix Tournechon who gave ballooning a new image. He was a fashionable cartoonist and photographer better known as Nadar. In 1863, he whipped up a storm of publicity with his latest stunt.
The Society for Aerial Locomotion is proud to announce the event of the decade, the ascent of its giant hot air balloon from the Champs-Élysées. On board, our guests are leading personalities of society and the arts. No expense has been spared to equip the expedition for every eventuality. fine wines, sweetmeats, delicacies, even an interpreter, fully conversant in the languages of all the tribes of Africa.
In fact, they only got a few miles before crashing into a poppy field. The story of what might have happened had his intrepid crew reached Africa had already been written by his friend and the secretary of his society, Jules Verne. Verne's novel, 5 Weeks in a Balloon, took its readers up into the skies and described a startling new point of view.
At 2 o'clock, Timbuktu, the mysterious queen of the desert, appeared beneath the balloon. Dr. Ferguson was able to confirm the accuracy of the explorer's maps. The town plan forms a huge triangle on the wide plain of white sand. As for Timbuktu itself, the reader can imagine a heap of dice and marbles. That's what it looked like from the air.
However evocative Verne's description was, taking a camera up in a balloon gave everyone the chance to see for themselves. A city viewed from above revealed patterns of life hidden from the insect-like figures below. But if you wanted to go further still, it was back to the pages of Jules Verne. 5 Weeks in a Balloon launched Verne on his career as a science fiction storyteller. For the next 40 years, he took his readers on fantastic journeys from the center of the earth to the bottom of the oceans, across the heavens, and out into space. Verne described the fantastic in meticulous detail. The challenge to early filmmakers was how to make it as convincing, how to catch up with Verne's cinematic imagination. As early film audiences got used to impossible journeys of all kinds, they started to feel these weren't only possible, but inevitable. They even began to feel they had already happened in the real fantasy of cinema. But journeys needn't only be through space. They could also cross time. Traveling in time was already quite a popular idea when H.G. Wells showed how to do it.
There are really four dimensions. Three, which we call the three planes of space, and a fourth, time. There has, however, been a tendency to draw an unreal distinction between the former three dimensions and the latter. As it happens that our consciousness moves intermittently in one direction through time from the beginning to the end of our lives. So to travel in time could be as easy as riding a bike. I can go forwards, backwards, up and down. So why not to and fro in time? Of course, when I set off, you'll be left behind. Unless you come with me.
But maybe you didn't need to go off exploring time as if it was some kind of unknown region. What if you could just sit tight and have it travel round you? One reader of Wells' story was a scientific instrument maker in London named Robert Paul. Caught up in the newborn moving picture business, Paul had already built a copy of Edison's peep show machine, the kinetoscope, and then had gone on to devise his own camera to supply new films for it. However, the dream of time travel really set his inventive mind spinning. Here was an opportunity to put his film equipment to new and exciting uses, and, if he was successful, to make big money into the bargain. He wrote out a patent application for a novel form of exhibition whereby the spectators have presented to their view
scenes which are supposed to occur in the future or past, while they're given the sensation of voyaging upon a machine through time. The mechanism I employ consists of platforms which contain a suitable number of spectators, with an opening which is directed towards a screen upon which the views are presented.
Well, Paul never did strike it rich with his time machine. He never got around to actually building one. Probably couldn't find the time. For within a year, he had become the main supplier of films and movie equipment in Britain. Funny business dealing in time.
Provoking. I've cut it several times already, but they always join on again.
You don't know how to manage looking glass cakes. Hand it round first, then cut it afterwards.
Ooh, very nice.
Oh, no, thank you. Not for me.
No. No, cut it up.
Alice had discovered that the only way to go forwards in Looking Glass Land was by going backwards. It wasn't just Victorian fantasy that made free with time. 40 years after Alice, it could be saved and spent like money, squeezed and stretched. Thanks to recent inventions, it could be collected in the form of photographs, gramophone records, piano rolls, and now moving pictures. A film was a manufactured piece of time, and it was the Lumiere brothers who inadvertently introduced most of the world to the delights of time travel. Louis and Auguste were already established as a family photography business when in 1894 their father bought a kinetoscope designed by the American inventor Thomas Edison and challenged them to improve on it. The kinetoscope only allowed the viewer to watch a continuous loop of moving pictures, but the Lumieres succeeded in devising a more versatile system that was both projector and camera, the cinematograph. One of the first demonstration films was of their own employees finishing work at the Lumiere factory. Unlike Edison's bulky camera, the cinematograph was highly portable. Real life could now be recorded as it happened. Cinematograph could run backwards as well as forward. When it did, the audience couldn't believe their eyes. They were seeing the impossible. Exhibitors soon made reverse motion a regular feature of their programs, and 5 years later, it had become the sole attraction of a film like this one. Delighted with this new illusion. It made them masters of time, which could now be manipulated before their very eyes. Cinema began to play with time before Albert Einstein made it incomprehensible with the theory of relativity. Film as a time machine was beginning to intrigue other heavyweights too. Sigmund Freud, Marcel Proust, and even the French philosopher Henri Bergson.
When I first saw the cinematograph, I realized it could offer something new to philosophy. The cinema provides us with an understanding of our own memory. Think of the individual films, or even the frames that make up these films, as so many small moments which can be replayed in the same way that we summon up memories. Indeed, we could almost say the cinema is a model of consciousness itself. For when the machinery is at rest, you see nothing. But when it's moving, then it seems alive. Going to the cinema turns out to be a philosophical experience.
The older I get, the less I look forward to going out. And if this novel gets any longer, it should stop a few other people going out, too. I haven't seen any of the new films for years, but I hear they're getting more sophisticated. Some have even compared them with my book. They say the latest films can take you right inside a character's mind. Where will it end? Perhaps they could send it down the telephone. Just as they do now with plays from the theater. Imagine. How about some cake? Remind you of anything?
I've often thought that what a patient does in analysis is like trying to describe the view from a moving train. But recently, some of my younger patients have been telling me about the kino. And one or two colleagues, like Young, Otto Rank, for instance, have suggested this could be another route into the unconscious. A jumble of images that are projected in the dark. Like dreams, they say. In these crude film fantasies, might one find the equivalent of those processes which allow us to interpret dreams? The kino is a vulgar modern entertainment, and I doubt if it can tell us anything serious about the human condition. Except that we live in decadent times.
Decadent for some, but increasingly cost-effective. Everywhere time meant money, and workers on the new assembly lines were made to turn their time into profit. People came under pressure from clocks, timetables, schedules, and deadlines of all kinds, the more they needed opportunities to escape into private, personal time. The time of fiction, dreams, fantasies. At the movies, the workforce could take its revenge on the new tyranny of 20th century time. In this French comedy, a man can't inherit his fortune until he reaches a certain age. So, he speeds up the central Paris clock and life accelerates. Novelty of reverse action and the fun of speeding up and slowing down, it slowly became clear that moving pictures had introduced literally a new dimension into everyday life.
Within just a few years, the cinema had become a space and time machine, a way of imagining the impossible. And because it offered escape, the last machine was a compensation for all the other machines that now had such a hold on people's lives. Long before audiences had ever heard of relativity or psychoanalysis, they could play games in the dark with space and time and memory. It was like a rehearsal for the modern world, a playground for those learning how to cope with the new century.